All right, so welcome back to another episode of Fast Casual Nation. My name is Paul Barron. I'll be your host today. And today we're going to be breaking down a project and a brand that is based here in South Florida, one that we actually kind of close to us. And that is Pincho. And a little bit about what they've been able to do as becoming one of the top brands in fast casual in terms of sentiment growth in 2023. So we thought we'd bring in one of their founders and CEO to kind of dive into what they've been doing right. So you guys don't want to miss this one. Make sure and stick around. Let's get right into it. And I want to welcome into the show, Mr. Otto Othman. Great to have you, man.
Hey, what's up, Paul? Thanks for having me, man.
Yeah, let's get into a few things here. First thing I want to do is learn a little bit more about what Pincho Factory has been able to do in 2023 in terms of growth. Where do you guys stand today in terms of unit count and what you guys have been up to?
Yeah, for sure. So as you might know, or you remember, we did a deal with the Savory Fund. So mm-hmm. we did a big round there, terrific partners, and we set our sights to start growing in Houston.
Yep.
So this year we've opened two locations in Houston. So we're a total of 12 restaurants now, and we have a few more in the pipeline. So we have another one coming up now in January 19th. Mm-hmm. And a few more this year in the Houston area. So very, very exciting.
I think with Houston being one, first of all, a really good fast casual market center, was there anything that drew you to Houston specifically, or you just like Texas in general?
So we've had, once upon a time, we've had a lot of interest from a franchise perspective. A lot of people asking us to open up in the Houston market when we mm-hmm. were franchising. But as you know, we're not franchising anymore. We're doing company owned all the way. So we had some sort of intuition that Texas was going to be a good market just purely because of demand from guests that would call us all the time and tell us you guys should open here. But then we've hired a software company called Sitesus that has helped us with data. We geofenced every single one of our restaurants for, I think, 20, 30 days. And we got terrific data of what our, you know, we built a psychograph around our guests and what the guest spending habits is, who they are, what they like, so on and so forth. And then we threw that on the map of the U.S. And lo and behold, Houston was right at the top of that list. So it was kind of like data that confirmed our gut intuition. And we said, yeah, let's go for Houston, right? You know, there was California, there was New York. California is a bit too far for us. New York's slightly intimidating for us as well. You know, New York is one of those markets that I think South Florida brands are kind of reluctant to go to as their
right.
first market outside. So we said, let's go to Texas. It's a great market, very favorable, great labor, great. Houston's incredibly diverse. I mean, I was blown away by it. It's very much like Miami, very foodie town. So we said, let's do it. And we've opened our first location this year, I think was in June, mm-hmm. June 22nd. And it was a massive success. And, you know, we had lines out the door. Great.
Yeah, I'm looking at the lines right here on your LinkedIn. That was crazy. Man.
Yeah. And our stores, you know, we're in terms of guest satisfaction there, it's been phenomenal. People are sending us messages, telling us finally, you know, food with flavor. And, you know, we're, as you know, you've been to Pincho, you know, we're foods, you know, with flavors you've never experienced before. Mm-hmm. So it's very seasoned, bold flavors, you know, inspired by Latin America. So it has been received extremely well.
Well, I think, you know, opening up new markets, these are always challenges. I think that a lot of fast casual operators, they kind of, some people anticipate a certain level of success.
Right.
In some cases, a little bit, you know, concerned with whether or not it's going to hit within those markets. You look at what Pincho has done from a menu standpoint and being able to resonate. Because I would say Texas, somewhat Midwest. So you would think yep. Dallas, Austin, markets like that, they're going to have a little bit of understanding of what you guys have done. Do you feel like your menu matches up well with what's happening in the Texas scene right now?
I mean, absolutely, right? It's interesting because we're selling a lot more kebabs in Texas than we are in Miami, like 3x. It's incredible. So, you know, I think, you know, we obviously, when we open up our first location, we've listened to our guests tremendously. We were talking to everyone, really looking at the P-mix, trying to understand what's moving, what's not moving. But at the end of the day, Paul, that's our motto. It's foods you know with flavors you've never experienced before. So it's burgers, chicken sandwiches, bowls, and kebab plates. You know, these are foods that they're pretty universal. And on the flavor profile, people were blown away by it. We were received extremely well. Extremely well. I think the only feedback that we got there, I guess we're still working on, we need a little bit more of spiciness. So people wanted spicy food, which here in Miami, it's not like a big thing. So we're working on the new burger called the Jalapeno Delight that's going to drop very soon. That's nice, flavorful, and has a nice kick to it.
Very cool. So good matchups, I think, with, picking the right markets. So that's always helpful. I think the fact that you guys went the route of, you know, software and really analyzing some of the data analytics that are out there is kind of intriguing to me. And when we look at, because one of the reasons we asked you on today's episode was to break down a report that we did. We do this on all of the fast casual groups, usually the top 100 restaurant brands that we look at, you know, within what we call the Restaurant Power Index, the RPI. And basically what it does is it measures sentiment data around the brand, and it breaks down all sorts of different measurements around food, service, brand sentiment, et cetera. Pincho came in as the number one brand in terms of sentiment growth, meaning where you started the beginning of 2023 and where you end up. I want to show a chart here to those who are watching the video. By the way, if you're not watching the video on this podcast, guys, you can actually catch it over on Savorfm. Just go to Savorfm, look for this podcast, Fast Casual Nation, and you'll see it on the front page there. But I want to bring this chart up real quick, and I'm going to show it to full screen to you, Otto. And what you're looking at here is on the left, you've got the overall industry, and this is January through December of 2023. And you kind of see the ebbs and flow of the industry kind of going across there. Your second bar chart is the industry service sentiment, which has been dropping, by the way, and I want to talk to you about that. Then industry food sentiment, though a little bit higher, also came in lower by the end of the year, but not with Pincho. Pincho, you started a little low at the end of the year, but have been just consistently climbing through the months on your overall sentiment. So first of all, what have you guys been doing that's caused consumer sentiment to be so positive for 2023?
I'm afraid I cannot share that with you.
Secret.
That's the secret. Look, I don't think there's one specific answer. It was a lot of little things, right? It was very intentional. I think we've learned how to be better operators after we partner up with Savory. That's for sure. 100%. Okay. I mean, just the institutional knowledge that they brought on board. You know, I'm a first time founder when it comes to restaurants. So learning so much from the platform itself, I think that was probably the number one thing that added value to the brand. I think that was one. Second, we invested in, at the store level, we invested in developing our general managers. At the end of the day, Paul, this brand, I mean, any brand, it's really built on the shoulders of the team members, but specifically the general manager at the store level is the captain of that ship. Mm-hmm. So we leveled up general managers across the board. We developed the ones that wanted to be developed, and we gave everyone a chance. You know, we're a very, very culture forward brand. And I think that was the second key. And then third, we figured out how do we build more feedback loops between us and our guests, right? Building feedback loops between us and our guests, I think, is key to really understanding where is it that we're dropping the ball, what is it that we need to do differently, and just acting upon that feedback. And I think we did a terrific job in that aspect. So that's on the operational side, right? And then on the innovation side, one thing that we had moved away from because we thought it wasn't an important piece of the brand, which was this monthly LTOs, we figured that maybe we can move to, you know, an LTO every 2 months. And man, our guests killed us for that, right? Because it was something that we thought that maybe, you know, we'll do one LTO every 2 months, everybody's going to be okay with it. But part of what makes Pincho special is the monthly LTO. That's what people love. It's kind of like a shoe drop, right? Like culture-wise, people are waiting for the beginning of the month to receive a really cool and very relevant LTO, I guess is the best way to put it, that it's very flavorful and terrific. So we went back to doing monthly LTOs. And in addition to that, on the collaboration side, you know, between collaborations with local influencers, with chefs, coming up with weekend LTOs, you know, that are not, are specific just a few locations and not across the brand. A lot of little things like that really made us stand out this year. And it got us back on track to where we needed to be.
I was looking at some of the data credentials that we looked at, and these are the different layers of, let me share this screen just to add it to the scene here, and I'll bring it up for you. And I'm looking at it right now. And when we studied this, first of all, the categories are food service, brand, and the value of Pincho, which was right now your strongest category. When you look at the reviews and with influencers, with ratings and engagement, value was very high, as was overall brand, which was very high also. Especially, I wanted to look at the column of influencers. So in food, you had a 71 score, service you had a 69 mm-hmm. score, and then brand and value at a 76 and a 78. So why do you think people are looking at, especially from an influencer standpoint, that our people are looking at Pincho and saying, all right, this particular product represents really great value. The brand resonates with them. How do you guys compare to, say, your nearest competitor? Do you feel like you guys have just done something unique or different that would cause that to happen?
Well, you know, I think it goes back to why we started the brand, right? It's always been quality over everything, right? That's has been like a part of the DNA of the fabric. So a lot of people traded down in quality. A lot of people have gone to smaller burgers because they were affected by, you know, COVID and COGS going up, so on and so forth. We stay true to who we are. And if the price of food went up, we took the hit. We took the hit. We did not increase price. We did not take price increases like our competitors did. We stayed very much where we needed to be. I think in the last 2 years, we've taken maybe just two small price increases in the last 3 years. So I think that's one in terms of value, right? It's just making sure that we are doing what's right for our guests, because we truly believe that things were going to go down, and they did. And food did go down. So in that period where others took price, we didn't. I think that created that value proposition for our guests. And then when it comes to our food, Paul, you know, I think as we started scaling, our number one promise was, okay, how do we scale the brand and not lose soul, not lose who we are, not lose the like what we stand for? Like, we're extremely intentional about all these things. And I think that resonates with people, right? Because you hear all the time when people start expanding, the quality goes down, everything goes sideways. And then the perception from the guests is like, man, you know, they sold out. They got some money. They started growing. They're no longer a local brand. They're no longer, the quality's not there. We did the opposite. Like, the first thing that we did when we partnered up with Savory was said, okay, how do we scale this brand? What kind of technology are we going to invest in? What are we going to roll out across the system to make sure that we are consistent as heck, right? Across the board. And that as we're opening more stores, we're still what we call the local neighborhood burger joint, right? Like, that's the mantra of Pincho. Yeah, we always want to be that local neighborhood feel. And I think we did a really good job. We executed at a high level, and our guests clearly see us. So I'm happy to see those scores.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's good to see when brands are doing things right, especially when you look at the overall market, which declined a little bit in service quality and also in food quality. Why do you think we've seen service drop so much in the last 18 months? What do you think has been the pressure there?
I'll tell you, and this is something that we for a minute in 2022 had a bit of an issue with, right? You're looking at our brand prior to COVID, you know, we're very much hospitality driven, all brands, right? You're 70% of our business is dine in, 30% takeout, and then you flip that. And then as you flip that, Paul, and as you know, we have, you know, this industry has high turnover. So you're, you know, 21, 22, you're hiring people walking into your restaurant and majority of your business is takeout. You know, hospitality becomes like a second thought. It's not even a priority anymore because everyone is so worried about digitizing their guests. Everyone is so worried about signing up more people to their loyalty, making sure that their takeout game is strong. And then people forget about hospitality. So you have an entire workforce that has been hired and they have never had to deal with a full dining room because everything is to go, right? You know, right. So our business right now is about 70% takeout. You know, on the weekends we go to maybe down to like 60 where 40% is dine-in, but it's still 70% takeout. Mm-hmm. So you got to build really strong training systems and really double down and be intentional about hospitality and know for your sure. why. You have to understand your why. What's our why? Who are we? Are we a transactional brand that all we care about is that our food just gets out on time? Or are we a hospitality brand that even when our food is going to go, we're still thinking about how we're going to extend the hospitality to that guest, mm-hmm. right? When that yep. person opens up that Pincho bag, they're like, oh, wow, that was awesome. I can't believe that they dropped this snow. I can't believe that this was packaged this way. I can't believe that when I have a bad experience, I can just text this number. You know, these are the things that you have to do. So I think, you know, for large organizations, you know, I won't name a brand, but I did go to an incredible brand that I love. And, you know, this was, you know, a year ago. And it still feels like we're in COVID, right? You know, you still have like tables and chairs still yeah. like up in the corner, boxes in the dining room. I'm like, man, you know, we're 2023, you know, COVID was 3 years ago and you guys are still acting like we're in the pandemic. So I think that's basically what happened.
Well, and I think to your point, my concern is that there's an expectation of consumers from a hospitality standpoint that just has never returned. You know, when you go to a brand that used to go pre-pandemic, everybody right. would say the restaurant business is completely different now. Back to your point, labor, the expectations of consumer with third party, a lot of off-premise starting to take place. But the fact to see those numbers, and I just showed that on the slide, the declining, I'll bring that up again for those watching. I'll go to full screen here just so people can kind of see. But this right here is what I'm talking about. This started in January at an 8 of 58. This is industry service sentiment. And you can kind of see it just starts declining right here around September, August, September, October, November, another declining month in December, down to a 52.16. Now, right now, the last time we saw this was almost 8 years ago. We had never seen service sentiment this far down. So I don't know. This is a very intriguing situation. And I'm just wondering if there's brands out there, whether labor has continued to be the problem or if it's just consumer expectation now is becoming more of a, they're just like, hey, we don't think it was as good as it used to be.
Right. Right. Look, I mean, let's be honest, right? We're in the fast casual industry. When was the last time that you got up and said, I'm going to go take my family to dinner at a fast casual restaurant?
Right.
It's not the same. We used to do that very often mm-hmm. in the past, but it's not the same. So now when you do that and then the experience is not what you thought it was,
right.
People are choosing to stay home, right? People are choosing to order in and watch TV and watch their Netflix show or whatever. So I think expectations from the guests have changed. I think experience is going to have to level up because people are more enabled. They're like the only times that you really want to go out and spend time at a restaurant is if that experience matches your expectation.
Bingo. Right?
You say, you know what? I'm going to get in the car. I'm going to meet my wife. We're going to go have dinner. I'm going to go to Hillstone because I know in Hillstone is going to be an exceptional experience. But, you know, again, I don't want to name other brands, but any fast casual, you have to be really good, right?
Yeah.
I will get up and go eat at Pincho because I know I'm going to have a great experience at night on a Friday.
I go to the one not too far from our studio here in Sunrise, and they do a great job. And you guys go head to head with Chipotle. Literally, you're right. Yeah. It's one end cap to the other end cap. And before this interview, I got a chance to go over there last week, and I was just kind of looking at the traffic, and I was like, wow, Pincho's busy. Chipotle's doing okay. So, right. I mean, it's as though you guys have been able to hold your own against one of the best, I would say one of the best fast casuals out there, you know, with Chipotle.
Right.
Granted, they've had their problems, but intriguing that you guys have done so well in these continued markets. Let's talk a little bit about when you think on the side of convenience, because you just mentioned this, and I thought that was an insightful element in terms of families and just consumers in general saying, okay, I want convenience. How important is that for you guys going forward here in 24? Are you doing anything to change up how you're delivering convenience?
Absolutely. I mean, look, I think there's a time and place for technology, right? And I think we think a lot about technology from a point of view that it needs to add to the guest experience, right? We never want to add technology if it's not going to serve the purpose of hospitality. We don't want to add technology just because we want to save labor. We want to add technology because it's going to achieve a greater experience for our guests, and it's going to be beneficial for us as a brand.
Right.
So I think people now more than ever are, you know, time is our number one resources. I think people are beginning to realize that, and people are always on the go. So we're constantly trying to innovate on speed, on just making sure that the guest experience when it comes to ordering is as easy as possible, right? Starting from our mobile app to our web-based application, we've rolled out AI voice ordering system over the phone. Right. You know, we were one of the very first brands here, at least in South Florida, that did that together with a company called Kia, which was outstanding. And our guests love it, right? Because you pick up the phone, you call one of our restaurants.
Yeah.
It's incredibly accurate. And if you have a trouble with it, then we have someone, a real human, pick up the phone and help you through it. It's not like this really annoying experience. But the best part of it is the next time you call one of our restaurants, it just says, "Hi, Paul. Thanks for calling Pincho Sunrise."
Right. I've tried it.
Do you want to reorder it?
It works.
Tried it. All right.
Yeah, it works.
Do you want
great.
To reorder it? Like, yes, I do. So as you're driving is like the best, most convenient way, you know, because a lot of people, they make their decisions what they're going to eat when they're leaving work and they're in the car. Picking up your phone and placing an order while you're driving is not safe. So picking up the phone and just calling the restaurant is ideal. So a lot of people love that.
Yeah, unless you know the menu, you know, it's tough. You're right. It's tough.
Yeah. So I think convenience is everything. And, you know, we've tried, you know, and I'll share this with you, you know, we've tried to fight third party in the past. I'm like, you know what, let's try to convert as many people from third party to first party. Mm-hmm. And then we realized like, why are we doing that? Like our guests that want third party, let's just meet them there. Let's just make it work for us. You know, there's a price that they're going to pay for that convenience, as you know, right? There's a price there that they pay for it, but they love it, you know? And you go and you ask those guests, I'm like, hey, you know, how come you can order from us directly and you can save, you know, X amount of dollars. And they're like, look, it's not about saving.
It's convenience.
I just want to have dinner here at the house. I have family, I have friends. I want the food to come to me. So convenience is going to be key, I think, for 2024. It's going to continue. I think technology is going to keep helping us execute and deliver on that convenience. But I think it's really important that we don't trade convenience for hospitality.
Yeah.
I think people still want convenience, but they want incredible hospitality. So when we drop the ball, the guest wants to be able to talk to you very quickly, get that resolved, get that fixed. They don't want to go through, you know, surveys that are 10 pages long to get to you. They want to get to you right away. And I think that's a real important piece.
Yeah. To your point is, it has the ability to become, kind of a new special power. If you've got not only convenience, but also the ability to deliver great hospitality, you know, so that you can kind of play both sides of the plate for those who are wanting to do, all right, we're going to do dine in tonight. Let's go over cause we're on our way to something versus, but you still want an experience, you know? So, that's a tough one for sure. All right. So let's get into a couple of things here. I want to get into kind of a section in the podcast where we look at strengths and weaknesses. And if you were looking, and I'm sure you guys have kind of set your plan up for 2024, What are the weaknesses of Pincho right now that you're saying, okay, we've got to get better at this? Where are you guys today?
You know, I think one of our biggest priorities right now is just order accuracy. Order accuracy, okay. You know, a lot of our food is takeout now. You know, order accuracy is still top of mind. We've increased our scores to above 90 this year, which was a huge goal, which, you know, as you can see, you can tell. But, you know, I always say this to our team, you know, people pay us 100% of the money for 100% of the food. Right. So we got to continue driving that accuracy to get as close as possible to 100.
Right.
I think that's a big priority. And second, I don't think it's a weakness, but I think is one of our big goals is to continue growing in the Houston area. Mm-hmm. We've been received extremely well, and I'm incredibly thankful for the Houston community. But Paul, opening up a new market is a lot of work. You know, it's not, again, it goes back to what I told you. We don't want to be a transactional brand. We want to be a brand that people love. People are like absolutely 100% crazy about. Mm-hmm. So to do that, you have to plant seeds in the community. You have to be there. There's a lot of local store marketing that we need to do, from local collaborations with local chefs, with local celebrities, local influencers, to partnering up with other brands and leveraging their communities. I think that's a huge initiative that we want to achieve this year. Because Houston's a massive market. I think we can probably
fit you guys.
Yeah.
It's gonna be a good market.
I think so. I think probably fit, you know, 20 restaurants in there without a problem, you know, but I think we're setting our eyes for 15. But that's a huge priority for us.
Yeah. I mean, they've got that big outer loop, you know, you've got some great, suburban communities there. So it is it's interesting too, when you compare Houston to Dallas, those two markets have completely different topographics in terms of how the landscape is laid out, with Dallas and in their interstate setup. So you kind of have to go into the suburbs in Dallas, versus Houston has a little bit better lineup in terms of geographical, where you could actually put more stores. So I think it's a good spot for you guys.
Yeah, you're driving. I remember driving for 1 hour and you're still in Houston.
Yeah, it's forever. Forever. All right, so that's the challenge. Let's talk about the opportunity that you guys feel, hey, this is going to be something we really need to focus on because it's going to be huge for 2024.
We think customization, you know, continuing giving our guests the customization that they want, that they ask, you know, but how do you achieve that without complicating ops, I think is the goal. It's very, very much top of mind. Making sure that we are controlling our COGS as we go into 2024 to the extent that we want to at all times. I think these are things. But if you really go to opportunities, that what we're talking about 24/7 is how do we really double down on experience without becoming a full service restaurant, right? So like, what is the fine line of like leveling up the fast casual game, right? Because QSR and fast casual, the lines between them are blurring a bit, right? Really, if you think about it, QSR right now is trying to do what we are doing. So we need to kind of level up our game a bit. But how do you level up a game of a fast casual, but without it being too convoluted, without it being a full service restaurant all of a sudden? I think that's where we're headed, right? From a terrific beer lineup to, like, you know, to TVs and great, you know, like sports, like these are all the things that we're talking about. Like, how do you turn Pincho into a place that not only does great takeout, which we do, but, you know, if only 30% of our business is dine in, 30 to 35, how do we increase that from 35 to like 55 or 60% dine in and have that all be incremental? And I think that's not something that just Pincho's thinking about. I think a lot of other fast casuals are thinking about that as well, because we are building smaller stores, but we don't want to build tiny stores either, right? There's something about the brand that we still wanted to be authentic. We still wanted to be a place where people go break bread with each other and hang out and have a local craft beer and enjoy an incredible burger and share with their friends and family. So I think that's a big project that we're working on now, is like how to level up the experience without without complicating and moving away from who we are.
Yeah, you guys have mentioned technology a couple of times here in the interview. AI, obviously the use of apps quite a bit. And if you look at growing the loyalty component of a brand, this is something, you know, we've been focused on here at our organization, talking to founders and leaders around this whole idea of loyalty and brand IP, you know, just being able to create these rabid, you know, fans. It's happening in other sectors of retail. Food has been, back to your point, you've said it a couple times, is don't become transactional. You know, you want to become that destination point, or you become, you know, a restaurant concept that is, you know, the customers just fall in love with. Is there a tech out there right now that you're excited about that might be able to help you get to that level in terms of creating a much more loyal fan base?
Yeah. So, you know, we've been early adopters of the Thanks platform, and they have done a terrific, terrific job. I mean, these guys are innovating year over year. And that has helped us tremendously. I'm a huge believer that at our size, the best loyalty provider right now is Thanks. I mean, the things that we can do right now are incredible, Paul. I mean, we have so much data from our guests, right? We can target people, have one-on-one messaging. We can really, really get down and dirty and look at this data, because in the previous world, we have all of this data and we didn't know what to do with it. Because you needed to hire a chief scientist to come in and look at all of this data and come up with, you know, actionable stuff that we can do to really, you know, drive our sales. But I think with the Thanks platform, we've been extremely lucky. Cool. So from building loyalty has been 10 times easier because of having someone like them.
Well, you know, the growth, we just did some research on McDonald's, and I was surprised at how fast their loyalty program had grown. You know, for a brand their size, typically it's more of a lumbering giant. You know, grow by just being relevant, and, you know, you have a digital, whether it's an app ecosystem, but they've really accelerated, you know, their digital footprint and in terms of loyalty, true loyalty engagement. So that'll be intriguing to watch, back to your point, to brands your size versus, say, brands, you know, the size of McDonald's out there. Are there similarities in how these technologies are starting to work in terms of growing that? Is there, last question to you, Otto, and that is, when you look at 2024, is there anything right now that you're concerned about for growth of your own brand, but maybe for the restaurant, you know, environment or economic situation as a whole? Anything you're concerned about right now?
You know, I'm hoping 2024 is going to be finally the year where we're all going to say, yes, we're back to normal, because, you know, 2021, 22, and 23, they were tough years. They were not easy, right? 2022, I thought we were out of it, and it was very tough. But for 2024, I think, you know, the priority for us, and what I feel I'm slightly concerned with, is just here in South Florida, spending habits, the cost of housing is through the roof, man. I mean, it's impacting our team at this point, right? We have team members that can't afford to pay their rent. So I hope that housing in South Florida will go down a bit, so people can finally, you know, not be so concerned about their mortgages or their rent payments. Mm-hmm. But spending habits is what I'm concerned about. I'm concerned that we're still not out of this so-called recession that we all keep talking about. It feels like we're in one, but we're not in one.
Yeah.
But, you know, you can totally feel that there's something up in the air. But that, I think that'll be my biggest concern. I want us to finally go back to saying, yes, we have, you know, incredible GDP growth, and people are finally back, and we're spending, and everything's okay. And the cost of steak and beef is not going to keep rising. It's going to go down. You know, like, these are all the things that I hope that we're out of. But I'm still concerned about the rise of cost, all of our commodities, right? Every year, it's something new. in the cost of housing.
Well, you hit on 2 points there. I think obviously with inflation being somewhat sticky, even though it has started to come down slightly, I was looking at the FOMC meeting with Chair Powell the other day, and the fact that he was a little bit more dovish in terms of their outlook, meaning the Fed's probably going to start cutting interest rates in this year. But still, to your point, credit is at a all-time high for consumers, which means they've kind of exhausted their credit card or access to credit. That slows spending. I think you're right to be concerned about this, because as 24 starts to heat up here, if we see any kind of macro pressures, that could really put some, you know, some problems into the spending bucket of just where families are saying, how many times are we going to eat out this week? You know, kind of situation. So I would agree with you. That's the one to watch for sure. Hey, Otto, it's always fun kind of chopping it up with you. Thank you so much for coming in on the podcast today. We appreciate it very much. Good luck to you and everything you're doing at Pincho.
Thank you, man. Appreciate it, Paul. Thank Great you very much.
You. All right. Take care. All right. You guys are tuned in maybe on the podcast and you're watching us over on Savorfm, or maybe you're catching this on the audio version of the podcast, whether that's on Apple or Spotify or other, whatever podcast player you might be listening in on. By the way, if you're not using a podcast 2.0 player, you should check out some of them. You'll learn a little bit more about some of the players out there that can get to a lot more interesting features within it. So check it out. We're all available out there on those as well. And if you're not subscribed to the Saver email list, make sure and just hit subscribe to our Substack. That'll get you in, and you'll get, of course, access to all of our updated podcasts. And hey, we'll catch you next time right here on Fast Casual Nation.